Well, some of you may recognise those bells. We are, in fact, standing over 200 feet above London in Big Ben. And if I'm looking a little bit tired out, it's because I've just walked up nearly 350 steps. And with me is the clock keeper.
Clock guide.
Clock guide is Brian Davis. Brian, I mean, that's a long way, but I mean, you do that about four times a day, don't you?
Yes, anywhere up to four times a day, depending on the booking, number of bookings that are coming in.
You must be a fit man. Now, obviously, this must be the most famous clock in the world.
Yes,
but obviously, Big Ben isn't actually the clock, it's the bell.
It is the large bell, which is behind you there.
I see. How old is it?
It was operating as a working bell from 1859.
It's quite a while ago, isn't it? Yes. You obviously have a few problems every now and then with it, don't you?
Yes, we've had a crack appear in the bell. This appeared in 1861.
Yes.
And that crack is still there to this day. It's on the far side of the bell, which I'll show you when we go around.
Oh, that'd be great. Yes, thank you.
And that's the only, shall we say, problem we did have.
Yes.
Because the crack in the bell has not altered the tone of the bell, and it hasn't gone any deeper than the copper skin or copper coating, technically there is no damage.
How long do you expect it to last?
That I cannot answer. I don't know enough about the technical side to be
able to
answer.
But sooner or later, someone's going to have to replace it, aren't they?
Yes. It will need turning before much longer, because there is showing considerable signs of wear underneath the large hammer that strikes Big Ben, as you can see.
Yeah.
So I think it would rest with the powers that be as and when they get around to turning it.
Of course, it's part of the Palace of Westminster.
Yes.
Was it just originally built just to have the clock and the bells?
No, I believe originally the tower was built as a tower to pair up with the Victoria Tower at the far end of the palace.
Yes.
Then somebody decided it would be nice to have a clock in it, and then the bells and so forth.
And it was used at some time as dungeons or cells?
One particular room was used as a prison cell, and the last, shall we say, lucky person to be locked in there was our Miss Emily Pankhurst, who was one of the leaders of the suffragette movement.
That's right, yes. Tied herself to the railings and said, silly girl.
And the Sergeant at Arms had her cut free and locked in that room as a punishment.
It's not a bad place to stay, though, is it? You've got a beautiful view right across the river.
Yes, but when you hear the bell striking every hour and one isn't told how long you're going to be locked in there.
Yes.
Every hour must have seemed like a lifetime.
Well, Brian, thank you very much indeed.
You're welcome.
Looking at my watch, it's nearly 2 o'clock.
Yes.
Just about ready to hear the bells.
Yes.
Now into the clock mechanism room, and you can hear behind me the sedate tick-tock as Big Ben's clock ticks away the hours. Brian, this was installed round about the same time as the Big Ben himself, wasn't it?
Yes, and it was operating continuously from 1859.
How on earth did they get it up here?
The mechanism, the bulk of it came up the well of the stairs that we've just walked up.
Yes.
The smaller pieces carried up the stairs. Now, it will be noisy when this starts. Now, that...
Once more? No, it definitely wants a last word, doesn't it?
Yes, that ratchet sound, to us, sounds like sweet music.
Yes.
That is telling me the chiming mechanism is working properly. So we look forward to hearing that peculiar sound.
Yes, indeed. Now, obviously, you've had a couple of stoppages, but one sort of almost major disaster, didn't you?
Yes. This happened at 3:45 on August the 5th, 1976, in the early hours of the morning. The far end of the mechanism that contains that large cable drum, that operates the four chiming bells that we saw upstairs. And at that particular time in the morning, that section broke and ended up flying all over the place and done considerable damage.
Yeah, it's a good job nobody was here, wasn't it?
Yes. It doesn't bear thinking about what would have happened had we had a party of people in here.
Yes, indeed. How long then was the clock out of action?
From August 1976 up until just prior to the Queen's Silver Jubilee.
Yes.
That end section was remade and refitted by a local firm called Thwaites and Reed.
Yes. And how often is it wound up then? Is it wound up?
Yes. Nowadays it is electrically rewound. And it's rewound Monday morning, Wednesday morning, and Friday morning.
Yes.
The clock man's a very happy man, because his work is made much easier. The motor you see in the centre here winds the weights for him.
Yes, I see.
In the early days, it used to be rewound by hand 7 days a week.
Yes.
You can see the two handles, one either end, that the men used to use.
Yes. Now, obviously, it's a very finely balanced piece of equipment, isn't it?
Yes.
How do you make sure that, you know, it's telling the right time?
The clockman checks his time from a clock we have in that white cabinet on the far side of the room.
Yes.
And when the clock needs to be readjusted, usually for very sharp changes in temperature, this affects the timing. Depending which way the temperature goes from hot to cold, cold to hot, the clockman, he may have to put one or two pennies onto the pendulum, or he may have to go the other way and take one or two pennies off of the pendulum. This is a method used for minor time adjustment.
Just ordinary pennies?
Yes, so simple.
Decimal coinage?
No, that's the old-fashioned large copper pennies that we used to have as children. It was a long time ago. Which are on the colour of the pendulum at the back of the frame.
Yes, yes.
When we go into British summertime, Thwaites and Reed come in, they stop the clock working. The reason it stopped early Saturday evening is it gives them a chance to carry out the very important maintenance work the mechanism needs.
Yes.
When that work is completed, they then put the clock right and start it off. This procedure is repeated again at the end of British summertime when our clocks go back.
Right, well, our last port of call, Brian, is actually behind the clock face itself. And it's not until you get behind here you realise just how massive it is.
No, it is a very large one. It measures 23 feet from top to bottom, left to right.
I see.
There are 365 panes of glass, one for each day of the year.
Yes, it's actually amazing, isn't it?
Yes.
And of course, behind us are the lights.
Yes.
Which are switched on.
Lights, when they're burning, they're giving off in light power equivalent to burning 10,000 candles to light up one clock face.
Yes, it's amazing, isn't it? How far away can that be seen, then?
Well, I would think over most of the London area, providing the people know where to look for it.
Yes. Well, Brian, you obviously have a lot of affection for the clock and for Big Ben, don't you?
Yes, it's... what shall I say? It's different to everything else, and I enjoy it, and I hope our visitors go away happy. That's the important thing.
Well, Brian, you certainly made us happy. Thank you very much indeed for showing us around.
You're welcome.
Now, unfortunately, I've got to go back down those stairs again.
Yes.